millions of children around the world will spend this holiday season in one of the least festive places you can imagine, a refugee camp. Displaced from their homes by war, violence, disasters, these children face a precarious existence, devoid of the most basic necessities most of us often take for granted. There's a chronic shortage of nutritious food, fresh water, warm clothing, health care, education. According to the UN, as of 2017, more than 68 million people worldwide have been displaced. 25 million of them are classified as refugees. That means often living in squalid, unsafe conditions. And half the refugees in the world are children under the age of 18, kids who have no means to fend for themselves. One critical factor affecting these children has often been overlooked, and that is playtime. It's a way for them to cope with the trauma, a way of keeping their minds and bodies engaged in healthy activities, a way for them to be happy, even if only for a moment. In other words, bringing a moment of sunshine into their lives. And perhaps no one understands better the importance of play in the development of young children than these guys, the people behind Sesame Street. Now soon, they and the Sesame Street Muppets will begin working their magic on Syrian and Rohingya refugee children. All of this thanks to a $100 million grant from the Lego Foundation. All right, with us from New York to explain more about this are Sherrie Westin, President of Global Impact and Philanthropy at Sesame Workshop, and Sarah Bouchie, Vice President of the Lego Foundation. Thank you so much to both of you for joining us. Our team here really loves the idea behind what you're doing. Sherrie, perhaps I'd like to start with you, and can you explain to us what it's like, your teams have experience doing this, going to see some of the unluckiest kids in the world and telling them, hey, I'm going to play with you.
Well, I think the thing is, you know the power of Sesame Street, and it's proven educational content. We have almost 50 years of experience, and you're right, these children deserve a childhood, but most importantly, they deserve quality early childhood development. And many have left everything they've known, their schools, their homes. They've been through a great deal of crisis, as you can imagine. And the most important thing to do is to reach them in those critical early years with quality learning.
How do they react?
Well, you can see from some of the images you're showing that one of the things I love is that these Muppets have just universal appeal. And children everywhere connect with them, they relate to them, they bring joy to the children. And so it's a wonderful thing to see children reacting to the Muppets. But most importantly, we're reaching them with education. I think you mentioned a little bit about the statistics at the beginning, and less than 3% of all humanitarian aid goes to education, and a fraction of that goes to early education.
And so also so almost so nothing, important. In other words. Almost none of the money actually goes to education. And you're right, this gets overlooked. I did not suspect that.
Right. Well, it's somewhat understandable. When you think of a refugee crisis, there's shelter, there's immediate needs to save lives. But as these crises are more and more extended, where children and families are displaced for much longer periods of time, if we're not investing in education, we're not giving these children a path forward. And that's an entire generation lost.
Sarah, tell me why the Lego Foundation wanted to zero in on this.
Well, the Lego Foundation believes deeply that every child should have an opportunity to learn and grow in a playful and meaningful way. We have spent the last 10 years really evaluating what evidence works to help children grow and learn. And we have seen that playful ways, when things are meaningful and joyful and interactive and iterative, that children learn better and they're more engaged. And when they're more engaged, it helps to develop these critical neurological connections that are needed in order for healthy brains to grow. And in a situation like this, when you know that kids are experiencing so much trauma, having the resilience that you need in order to grow strong is important. And we feel like if we can do something, we should. And drawing attention to this issue is really important to us.
And tell me a little bit more about that, because I read your literature, and it's very eloquent in the way it explains that, you know, these are children who've been hurt, who've often been traumatized. I mean, in the case of Rohingya children, and we've covered this extensively on CNN, there are people who fled their homes. They saw murders. They saw sexual violence against their parents, against their neighbors. And all of a sudden, they find themselves displaced in a place that they've never been in before. Many of them are in Cox's Bazar now, in a totally different country in Bangladesh. You will be working, Sesame Street will be working with some of these children. What exactly are their needs and their fragilities?
Well, there's one really important thing. We know from science that kids need basically three things. Three things when children are behind. First of all, you need to intervene early. And make sure that there is a caring adult in their life that can help to ground them and give them a sense of routine and boundaries and help them to process the feelings that they have. We know that you have to give them opportunities to develop critical life skills, and those are the kinds of skills that help you regulate when do you prioritize things and how do you hold back when you're excited about things. And we know that in order to help them grow and develop, that reducing stress is really important. Oh. And play does all three of those things in a really critical way.
Sherrie, this is a sad question. I honestly wish I didn't have to ask it, but is it ever too late? Do you ever work with children where you think, if we had only got to them earlier, we could have course corrected?
Listen, that is the whole point of this. I think the reason this grant is so important, and before it, the MacArthur grant, because quite frankly, a year ago, MacArthur stepped up and they were the first to invest a significant amount, $100 million, audacious philanthropy, in reaching young children in crisis settings. And they hoped, as we did, that it would be a catalyst for others to step up, because we know if we reach them in the early years, we have the greatest chance to change their trajectory, to give them a path forward. And for LEGO to step up and give a grant of the same size, $100 million, this is really transforming humanitarian response. And we want it to enlighten others, for others to do the same, because if we can change the way we respond to humanitarian crises and invest in reaching children in those critical early years, we literally can change their outcomes. And if they don't have the tools they need to thrive, how can they be expected to rebuild their societies? This is really an investment in a more peaceful, stable world for us all if we're starting to invest in giving children a path.
There are two partners on the ground, the International Rescue Committee and BRAC, each in the Syrian response region and in Bangladesh, who are working extremely hard with children and their families in all different sorts of ways. And we're proud for them to be a part of this consortium and the grant, and would encourage anybody who wants to find out more to think about the three recipients plus New York University that the LEGO Foundation has chosen.
Well, thank you so much to both of you, Sherrie Westin, Cyril, Bouchie, for your time and also your eloquence in explaining to us what this is all about. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for having us.
Thank you.